Now that we have covered the definition of a microgrid, let's have a look at possible scales, but also at some misconceptions that exist around the concept. In this video, you will be introduced to the different microgrid scales. After that, you will be exposed to some of the most frequent misconceptions. This will help you identify what is a microgrid and what is not. A way to classify microgrids is through their power capacity. A high-power microgrid has a power capacity typically from a few hundreds of kilowatts up to a few megawatts. The connection to the external electrical network can be done via the microgrid central controller, which regulates the power flows and the information exchange. The microgrid itself can consist of several distribution feeders, to which different types of loads, renewable sources, and storage units can be connected. A medium-power microgrid can be connected to the main grid, also via the central microgrid controller. In this case, the microgrid consists of a single feeder that connects generators and loads at distribution level. A bidirectional flow will exist at the single feeder, as well as information exchange between the microgrid's controller and the microgeneration owners at the distribution level, for example, information related to carbon trading and prices. A low-power microgrid consists of a single feeder and can be connected to several loads and generators. On a smaller size, a low-power microgrid can also be a single household that works both as load and generator, using solar panels, for example. The size of this microgrid is typically considered to be well below 1 megawatt. The microgrid central controller is the main responsible for managing and controlling all the loads and renewables in an intelligent and smart way. Now that we have covered the different scales that a microgrid can have, let's have a look at some misconceptions that exist around the microgrid concept. So first, it can be thought that microgrids are independent networks that exclusively work in islanded mode. However, as we remember from the definition, a microgrid can also operate in grid-connected mode, exchange power with it, and even provide ancillary services. Second, it can be believed that a group of customers who own microsources make up a microgrid. However, if there is no interaction with a central microgrid controller or a coordination between the actors, a group of customers owning microsources is not considered a microgrid, because management and coordination is the vital part of microgrids and active distribution networks, as we discussed in our previous lectures. Third, some people might think that microgrids are composed of only intermittent renewable energy sources, and that they are therefore unreliable and easily subject to failures and blackouts. However, microgrids are integration platforms, which allow the connection of not only renewable energy sources, but also traditional units. A good energy management system will prevent the microgrid from experiencing failures and blackouts. Fourth, it can be considered that microgrids are expensive to be built in all cases. However, the price of electricity can be high for some microgrids that contain high participation in renewable sources, but they can still represent a cheaper alternative in countries where the infrastructure is not currently available, for example. Finally, it could be thought that all privacy of the consumers will be lost. So, for example, that you would need to be forced to run your washing machine when the sun shines. However, forcing customers or limiting privacy is not the goal of a microgrid. Demand-side management is performed in order to increase customers' comfort and their role in the decision-making process instead. In this video, we had a look at different microgrid scales. As we saw, a microgrid can be as small as a household or as big as a cluster of several feeders of up to a few megawatts. Additionally, we identified some of the misconceptions around the microgrid concept. For example, that a microgrid is only meant to operate in islanded mode, as opposed to the definition that we covered previously, which states that a microgrid should allow two modes of operation, grid-connected and islanded mode. By understanding the definition and the misconceptions, it is possible to identify microgrids in an easier way. So, are you ready to spot them?